Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Managing ADHD in School, The Best Evidence-Based Methods for Teachers by Russell A. Barkley, PhD. Narrated by Mitch Crawford. Publisher's note, this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Managing ADHD in School into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code LEARN, and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures and examples referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Foreword. Although I have written many books for clinical professionals, parents of children with ADHD, adults with ADHD, and loved ones of adults with ADHD, this is my first book designed specifically for educators. I wrote this book for teachers because I know firsthand that they serve on the front lines of dealing with the educational problems that the vast majority of children with ADHD are likely to experience across their schooling. Another motivation for doing so was that the educational domain is the most impaired by ADHD and is impaired in the highest percentage of children and teens with ADHD than is any other domain of major life activities. Over 90% of children and teens with ADHD will experience classroom behavioral and emotional problems, peer relationship problems in the school, low academic achievement, or various adverse consequences associated with these difficulties, such as grade retention, placement in formal special educational services, and school suspensions and expulsions. Between 30 to 40% of them will not complete compulsory education in the United States because of these ADHD-related problems in school. Only 5 to 10% will complete a college education, which is 3 to 7 times less than the national average in the United States. In short, if ever there was a major domain of life that cries out for assistance for children and teens with ADHD, it is in school. Other books deal with ADHD in schools, so why listen to this one? What makes this book unique is that it goes beyond just describing the various and obvious problems children and teens with ADHD manifest in school. Other books explain what problems are associated with ADHD in the classroom, too. But this one goes beyond the what in order to explain why those problems are likely to exist. It tells you about the underlying neuropsychological difficulties in ADHD that create the various school-based problems seen in most children and teens with the disorder. ADHD is far more than just a problem with attention, hyperactivity, or impulsiveness. It is a disorder of the brain's executive system, a system essential for effective functioning in school and in most other important domains of life. As you will learn, ADHD disrupts the normal development of the brain's executive functions, meaning that ADHD is really an executive function deficit disorder, EFDD. And because the executive system is the basis for self-regulation, ADHD is also self-regulation deficit disorder, SRDD. This explains why ADHD is one of the most impairing, if not the most impairing, psychological disorder we routinely treat on an outpatient basis in clinical psychology and psychiatry. Seeing the why behind the what can better help both educators and clinicians to understand the reasons behind not only the problematic behavior of a child or teen with ADHD in the classroom, but also the why behind the choice of specific intervention methods. It not only sets out what educators can do to help, but, just as important, why those methods are likely to be effective. Moreover, by understanding the why, the reasons for the problems and for the treatments, educators can appreciate the principles underlying these treatments and so use those principles to develop new interventions on their own. For instance, teachers are often told to increase the frequency of consequences, to shorten work quotas, to allow frequent exercise breaks, or to add more structure, whatever that is, to the child's work area for children and teens with ADHD, among other stock recommendations. Why? Why should we do this for them when we don't do it for other children? The standard answer is because it works. That may be true, but don't you think it is even better to know why something works than just that it might work? Doesn't knowing the reasons behind the effectiveness of a treatment give us more understanding and power to develop even more and better therapies? Consider the classic case of how the British Navy learned that citrus fruits, such as limes and lemons, would treat scurvy. Yes, they learned eventually that it would work by simply giving them to some sailors and not others. But they didn't know why it worked. Once they learned about the role of vitamin deficiency in causing scurvy, they and all other sailors were better able to not just treat scurvy, but to prevent it. And that led to treating and even preventing other vitamin deficiency syndromes. It is the same situation with ADHD. Knowing the why it happens behind the what happens can greatly improve the effectiveness of current therapies and even lead to our developing new and better ones. Here I will tell you the why behind the problems shown by children and teens with ADHD in school, empowering you to be not only more knowledgeable about the nature of ADHD, but to be far more effective in dealing with those problems. What also makes this book unique is that I won't waste your time with a lot of narrative prose, needlessly detailed explanations, study-by-study research findings, and reference citations. You are far too busy for such excessiveness. Here, I will get right to the point, setting out in the chapters what problems ADHD poses for children and teens in school, why those problems occur, what you should do about them, and why those things should be done. I will be nothing here if not direct with you. Within will be the critical pieces of information you need to have, along with bulleted lists of effective methods you can use, and crisp, clear statements of the steps you need to follow to implement those methods. Nothing more. If you want stories, you can always read a good novel. But if you want to know precisely what to do to help a child or teen with ADHD in your classroom and why you need to do it, this book is definitely for you. This book provides an array or buffet of what can be done to address the problems and so achieve your goals of helping a child or teen with ADHD in your classroom. Of course, I don't expect you to undertake all of these methods. What steps to take depend, of course, on the child's specific school problem, his or her grade level and maturity, the time, opportunity, and resources you have to implement those steps, school policies, and, in some cases, the cooperation of parents to assist with any steps. As you know already, in designing a program to help any child, context is everything. So I give you a wide array of things to consider doing to help a child or teen with ADHD from which you can tailor what you believe to be the best plan for that child and context. I know that you know what is best for the child or teen you have in mind. And should you discover new ways to effectively treat a specific problem related to ADHD in your classroom that I did not cover here, please pass it along so I can do the same for other teachers in the next edition. My email address is drbarkley6769@comcast.net. Thanks. Chapter 1. What is ADHD? ADHD is a neurodevelopmental condition that consists of developmental delays or deficiencies in at least two types of neuropsychological abilities. These two dimensions are inattention and hyperactive impulsive symptoms. The disorder is classified as neurodevelopmental because the scientific evidence for the substantial role of neurological and genetic causes in ADHD is now overwhelming and irrefutable. ADHD is considered to be neurodevelopmental because it is primarily the result of a delay or lag in specific mental abilities. Those deficits are largely due to delays and/or dysfunction in the maturation of the brain areas that underlie those abilities. Such brain maldevelopment seems to arise largely from genetics, but can also occur as a consequence of damage or other disruptive influences experienced by the child or teen at any time during development, but most often during prenatal brain formation. The symptoms of ADHD are dimensional in that they reflect the extreme end of a continuum of normal or typical human ability in these two areas. Children and teens with ADHD have a disorder that is beyond their own choice or making, is intrinsic to their psychological and physical nature, is not a categorical condition like being pregnant, differs from the behavior and abilities of other students in these dimensions as a matter of degree, quantitative, not of kind, qualitative, will become evident sometime during childhood development, before 16 years in 98% of all cases, is likely to be pervasive across many, but not necessarily all situations, is likely to be persistent across development for many, but not necessarily all cases. The symptoms of ADHD. The symptoms most often evident in children and teens with ADHD include inattention, fails to give close attention to details, makes careless mistakes, cannot sustain attention to tasks or activities, doesn't seem to listen well, doesn't follow through on instructions, fails to finish work, cannot organize activities well, avoids or seems reluctant to engage in things requiring sustained effort, loses things necessary to complete tasks or activities, is easily distracted, forgets things, hyperactivity impulsivity, fidgets with hands or feet or squirms in seat, leaves seat when expected to remain seated, runs about or climbs on things where inappropriate to do so, is unable to play quietly, often seems to be on the go or driven by a motor, talks too much, blurts out answers prematurely, cannot wait, interrupts or intrudes on others' activities. These symptoms must occur at least often and to a degree that is excessive for their age. The child or teen exhibits a majority, six or more, of the symptoms on either list. Several symptoms must have developed in childhood before 12 years of age. These symptoms must have persisted for at least the past 6 months, must occur in two or more settings, home, school, work, community, and must lead to impaired functioning in major life activities, such as social, family, peers, community, academic, or occupational activities. Only a small percentage of children will meet all of these conditions, making those who do worse than 92 to 95% of the child or adolescent population in these respects. The deficient mental abilities contributing to the symptoms. I and many other clinical researchers conceptualize these symptoms as involving deficits in the following mental abilities, often referred to as executive functions. Hear more about these and their brain networks in Chapter 3, What Causes ADHD? Goal-directed persistence, inattention, and resistance to distraction. What separates the attention problems seen in ADHD from those evident in other disorders, such as depression, is that those with ADHD have problems with sustaining attention to and persisting toward the future. They are less able to persist at getting things done over time, in time, and on time that involve delayed or future events. They pay attention to what is happening now just fine, but not to what they need to be doing to be ready for what is coming next, or what they have been assigned to do. Even if they try to persist toward tasks or goals, they are more likely than others to react to distractions, which are events that are not relevant to the goal or task. Those distracting events are not just irrelevant things occurring around them, but also irrelevant ideas occurring in their mind. The problem here is not one of detecting those distractors better than others, but in failing to inhibit reacting to those distractors, as well as others. Working memory. A large part of their inattentiveness comes from the inability to hold in mind what goal they have chosen or been assigned, what that involves, and monitoring when it has been accomplished. This reflects a deficiency in working memory, which is remembering what to do. Memory for facts, knowledge, or information is not so much the problem as remembering what is to be done and persisting at it until it is so. Even if they try to hold such information in mind in order to guide their behavior toward a goal or task, such as instructions or assignments you gave them, any distractions will disrupt and degrade this special type of memory. The mental chalkboard of working memory is wiped clean by the distraction, and so the child is now off doing something other than what he or she is supposed to be doing. And having reacted to a distraction, and so gone off task, the child is far less likely to re-engage the original and now uncompleted goal or task. In sum, children or teens with ADHD are less likely than others to remember what they were supposed to be doing. Yes, ADHD children are forgetful, but as you can see here, it is a special type of forgetfulness. It is forgetting what they are supposed to be doing, forgetting the future. Inhibition. Children and teens with ADHD are not just impulsive, poorly inhibited, in their actions, which leads them to move around, touch things, and otherwise behave too much, the hyperactivity. Their deficit in inhibition extends to their verbal behavior, talking excessively, and to their cognitive activities or thinking, impulsive decision-making. It also interferes with their self-motivation, meaning that they are more likely than others to opt for immediate rewards or gratification. Put another way, they steeply discount the value of a future or delayed event or consequence, reward or punishment, more than others, causing them to have a high time preference. They prefer to have small results now rather than larger results later. Finally, their impulsiveness is evident in their emotions. They are more likely to display their emotional reactions and do it more quickly than do others of their age. And if strong emotions have been provoked by some event, they will have a far more difficult time moderating or otherwise self-regulating that emotion. So children with ADHD are less patient, more easily frustrated, quicker to arouse, more excitable, and sillier, yet also more likely to react with anger, and so more likely to respond with aggression when provoked. They show emotions that are less mature, appropriate, and consistent with or supportive of their future welfare than others. Planning and problem solving.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.